Hi there, I'm Jim Zirin. Welcome back for more conversations. It's not every day that I get to discuss current events with a Shakespearean scholar and Harvard professor who has won a Pulitzer Prize. Stephen Greenblatt is with us. He is the author of a marvelous book entitled Tyrant, Shakespeare on Politics. And he will discuss with us how Shakespeare's lines are strangely applicable to the contemporary political scene. We're pleased to welcome Stephen Greenblatt to the program. Well, Stephen, thank you so much for coming on and congratulations on the Tyrant. It's really a magnificent read and no more relevant than it is today, even though the book was published 2 years ago. Some things don't change. We've kind of seen an eruption of tyrants around the world. In Turkey, the Philippines, Hungary, Poland, and even the United States. So why do you suppose Shakespeare was so taken with tyrants and politics? Normally we think of Shakespeare as being taken with love.
Well, I think he did think about political matters actually all his life, but he thought about them, as it were, between the lines as often as he did directly. And that for good reason. We have to picture Shakespeare, I think, as writing everything he wrote, let's say not North Korea, but Czechoslovakia before the fall of that regime, or Iran now. That's to say, it's an extremely censored and oppressive culture that he lived in. He had to be quite careful, but he wanted to say what he had to say. So he figured out ways of doing it at oblique angles. But he lived in a world in which, as our world, you have to express yourself in some way or other about what you see going on around you. And Shakespeare found a way of doing it.
Of course, there were risks, because if he went too far, he might find himself without a head.
Yes, Christopher Marlowe, his contemporary, wound up dead at the age of 29 with a knife stuck in over his eye. And that was a good warning, if Shakespeare needed a warning, for what would happen if you were too open with what you had to say.
As I remember in King Lear, he refers to scurvy politicians. Did he take a risk when he made a statement like that?
He figured out how to do it, Jim. It is amazing, actually, as you suggested, he said things that would have got you in incredible trouble otherwise. He's in King Lear, same play, a dog's obeyed in office. If you said that
handy dandy, a dog's obeyed in office,
if you said it openly in the tavern in the conversation that someone was overhearing, you could find yourself without ears. They mutilated people routinely for remarks of that kind, and Shakespeare can do it before 2,000 people in the afternoon in London. How? Because the words are spoken, the words you've just quoted are spoken by a madman, the king who's gone mad. So Shakespeare could say, well, I didn't say this. This was a part of a play, don't you understand? And they did understand that within certain limits, you could say things that you couldn't say elsewhere.
It's the time's plague when madmen lead the blind. Now, are we seeing the time's plague now with Donald Trump? So many people besides yourself have seen parallels between Shakespeare and Trump. One, perhaps not so notably, is Steve Bannon at the time when Mueller was descending on Trump and subpoenaing witnesses. Bannon said, one thing is going to lead to another. The whole thing will unravel. It's Shakespearean. Do you see the Trump administration as kind of a Shakespearean tragedy?
I do, overwhelmingly. Whether it's a tragedy or a grotesque farce is a little unclear. And we probably won't know for a while how serious the damage is, how long lasting pervasive it is. But I do think that we are seeing, we can blame Donald Trump for many things, but we can praise him for making Shakespeare great again, for bringing Shakespeare very much present to us by his very destructive and terrifying behavior.
What about the tyrant or the protagonist as a madman? I mean, Hamlet spoke of putting attic disposition on. So when Trump denied that Biden had won the election and repeated it and insisted that he had won by a landslide, was it simply a political ploy and he was putting attic disposition on, or did he really believe it, in which case he was mad like King Lear?
This is a question I've asked myself for the last 4 years. I asked it even before 4 years, but when there was that initial business about, there's never been a bigger crowd at the inauguration, and then you saw the pictures, and it clearly wasn't. So did he think so? Did he not think so? And one of the things, again, that is useful, I think, about Shakespeare and the very example that you give, the antic disposition, is perfect for this. It's not clear whether this is madness or calculation, or rather the character in that case thinks it's calculation, but we have reason to believe it's madness. I've asked myself repeatedly, we've all asked ourselves, I think, whether what we're seeing is a sociopathic collapse, internal collapse of a personality, or whether we're watching cunning calculation. Your guess is as good as mine.
Well, tyrants through history have tended to blame others for their own misdeeds. I mean, Hitler is a great example. He blamed the Jews for the Reichstag fire that the Nazis had set themselves. Trump insists that no politician in history, and I say this with great surety, has been treated worse or more unfairly. This is King Lear, more sinned against than sinning. The parallel couldn't be more exact. So, I mean, if Shakespeare had been around today, wouldn't he have looked at this and said, I told you so?
I think Shakespeare thought there was a certain kind of personality that under certain circumstances has the opportunity to emerge. Those circumstances are radically factionalized party politics, a kind of a large number of people who feel they're not represented adequately by the existing system. And Shakespeare works out in quite a bit of detail what he thinks the preconditions are. And then under those conditions, a certain kind of personality, bullying, narcissistic, sociopathic, can emerge. But that personality can only emerge if there are substantial numbers of enablers. And that, in a way, is at least as much what Shakespeare was interested in.
You begin your book with that as the core question. How is it possible for a whole country to fall into the hands of a tyrant? Does Shakespeare give us an answer?
I mean, he does, I think, though the answer varies. There's not a single answer. The general assumption that the norms hold, that you can trust the system, whatever the system is, whether it's monarchical or democratic or oligarchical, you can trust that it will continue the way it goes. That trust is misguided and misleading, that things actually can break much more quickly than you anticipate that they're going to break. That's what's so frustrating about the current moment, I think, in our country, because we hold on to the illusion, and unfortunately it is only an illusion, that our system is so strong. It's been around for several hundred years and it's remarkably effective. We think that it will go on, but Shakespeare was certain that it doesn't go on that way. It's only as good as people, large numbers of people, being willing to buy into it. And when a significant number of people don't buy into it any longer, or when they're encouraged not to buy into it, then actually the norms can break. And that's what Shakespeare watches. He loves, from a dramatist's point of view, he loves watching that situation. It's grist for the mill for a dramatist to watch then a situation that looks stable fall apart.
Well, a democracy is fragile, but you also examine lying, mendacity as a tool by which a tyrant comes to power. And according to the Washington Post, I mean, a number of months ago, Trump had uttered 20,000 lies, demonstrable lies, since he'd been in office. And many found his lies to be charming. They were so outrageous. Is mendacity really a tool of the tyrant? Is it a lure to his followers, as you suggest in your book?
I mean, it's a lure. Mendacity is a principle of politics.
Never to this degree. It's a given politician.
On all sides. So we know that. But the question is why, under certain circumstances, does what looks like a modest lie cause an enormous to-do? And in other circumstances, such as the one we've just endured for the last 4 years, a constant, steady diet of obvious lies doesn't lead to the end of support. And that fascinated Shakespeare already from one of his earliest plays, those early Henry VI plays, where he has a character, a demagogue named Jack Cade, obviously lying. And the crowd laughs and enjoys the lies. Why? It enjoys the lies partly because, well, maybe for the same reason that we all like under certain circumstances, breaking certain things. It's pleasurable because we live in a constrained world and we love to break out, and breaking out, one way of breaking out is to lie. But another is that we enter a fantasy, and that Shakespeare is fascinated by a mob, a crowd entering a fantasy. You're going to eat for free. You're going to drink on my bill. You're not going to have to do anything. And so all that, the stuff in Shakespeare's case that he gives to this demagogue, the crowd knows that that's not true. They know whom they're dealing with, but they enjoy the holiday. The trouble is, what happens when the holiday is over? What happens when the price has to be paid?
Then you kill all the lawyers.
Then you kill all the lawyers. I'm sure the people who smashed the windows in the Capitol enjoyed the smashing. But what happens after this goes on? And what should be the responsibility of the elected officials, of the Ted Cruz's, of the Josh Hawley's, and of course of Trump himself, for what they've unleashed?
Well, they're among the enablers, undoubtedly. Do you see parallels between what Trump has done and the play of Coriolanus, which you treat in your book?
Coriolanus, of course, was one of Steve Bannon's favorite plays. I think he made a movie based on Coriolanus early in his career. I do think Coriolanus is an astonishing play for many, many reasons. And as always with Shakespeare, a complex and ambiguous play. It's not a simple story. It's always more complicated than it looks. But in the case of Coriolanus, where you have a violent and dangerous, hard right military figure, someone who didn't have bone spurs but was a military hero in Shakespeare's vision and the historical vision, what happens when he wants to destroy the existing institutions completely, which is what he wants to become, in effect, the tyrant of Rome? And the answer in the case of Coriolanus is what stops him are a set of different things, including his own psyche, his mother, but what stops him ultimately are a set of fairly low-level politicians, ordinary people. Their names in the play are Sicinius and Brutus, but they're like the most modest but most effective people who actually are not heroic, not giving grand speeches, but know how the system works and know how to stop, or at least to try to stop the worst from happening. And I do think that the ordinary procedures of the existing system, such as we're watching now in Congress, are probably, rather than the grand heroic, God help us, civil war gestures, are what counts, are what will, at least in Shakespeare's vision, what might save us. Just as the ordinary procedures might get us into trouble, it works in both ways. As I say, it's not simple.
Seems to me to be an analogy between how the tribunes turned on him and how McConnell possibly, and certainly 10 or 11 congressmen who had gone along with Trump over a long period of time turned on him in the impeachment.
I think that is true. I hadn't actually thought about this exact current moment where I was thinking about different, I was thinking about the popular tribunes, the equivalent of Nancy Pelosi in the play, not of Menenius Agrippa and those people, the ones who strongly supported Coriolanus from the beginning. They don't quite turn against him, but they begin to pull back. They begin to accept the fact that they'll be in terrible trouble if they go along with the craziness that Coriolanus represents at that point. I think that's true, actually. I'm grateful to you. I hadn't thought about that situation.
Well, I want an acknowledgement in your next book.
I will give you one.
Coriolanus winds up reaching out to the enemy of Rome, Aufidius, and forms what he hopes will be an alliance with him. And there's a parallel with Trump's reaching out to other tyrants. Kim Jong-un, who he said was a dear friend, he was in love with him, and with Vladimir Putin.
Suddenly, the Russians were our best friends, and we were being apologized for no matter what they did. I mean, against our own intelligence community. I think that situation which Shakespeare depicts in Coriolanus, in which Coriolanus, who's the absolute enemy of the Volscians, suddenly goes over to the Volscians, that situation I think is one that is deeply part of the world that we live in.
Who is justice? Who is thief? Handy dandy. And then he says, the dogs obeyed in office. So the sands continually shift in Shakespeare.
I mean, look, again, I want to say, and I think I've been thinking about this in the last, not just in the last few days, but through, my father was a Republican and ran for office as a Republican. My brother's a Republican. I mean, we don't live in a world in which there's absolute difference between one party and another. We have to live in a world in which we can find a way of speaking with each other. We've reached a kind of crazy point in which things are pulling in a wild opposite direction, and in which I feel a kind of, how should we say, crisis of the civic imagination. It's difficult for me to imagine who these people are, why they want this. And I'm sure they think the same thing of me. But we have to work our way back to a point in which we can imagine ourselves into the alternative worlds. And that is the situation Shakespeare sees. If it's not going to reach the tragic point of civil war, that's the situation we need to get to, in which we can have our imaginations be able to meet in the central place. Not agree, but we can respect each other.
Well, in your book, you also examine The Winner's Tale, where you have Leontes, I guess, a pretty decent ruler who paranoia descends into madness and basically becomes a tyrant. Maybe power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. But is there a relationship between paranoia, alternative facts, no proof, only continual insistence on that a proposition is so, even though it's not? Is a relationship between that form of madness in effect and tyranny?
I think that never being told that you're wrong, always being told that you are the absolute perfect ruler, Shakespeare sees as in Winter's Tale, as in King Lear and elsewhere, as the seeds of a disaster. And I was thinking recently of early in the Trump administration of that scene in which the cabinet had to go around and declare how profoundly admiring they were of the leader, and how he was perfect, and how he did this well and that well, and how grateful they were that God had given them Donald Trump and so forth. That's a situation Shakespeare does. That's a Shakespearean situation, as Shakespeare depicts it. And
Lear with his daughters. That's
exactly. Which of you, shall we say, doth love us the most? Exactly.
Wanted to be loved.
But the interesting question, Jim, is who speaks up in that situation, both in Lear and in Winter's Tale. Shakespeare is fascinated. Once you are in that situation, once you have a ruler who only wants to hear how great he is, who will come forward and say, well, you're not so great, or you've done this wrong, or you're heading in a very dangerous direction. And in both King Lear and Winter's Tale, in one case, tragically, in the other case, more or less comically, you have characters who come forward, and Shakespeare is fascinated by those characters who dare to come forward and say, stop, stop. And what we've watched over these last 4 years is how few people there are, how rare it is for even decent, intelligent people, when they find themselves in the presence of this kind of personality, how rare it is for people to risk everything by coming forward and saying, you're wrong, stop. Or I'm leaving, I resign. It happens, but it's very, very rare. And Shakespeare is fascinated by what it takes to do that.
Well, we saw this at the beginning of the Trump administration when Trump demanded loyalty of FBI Director Jim Comey. And he refused to give Trump fealty in the sense that Trump wanted it. And he was fired, which led, of course, to the Mueller investigation. But you make an observation of what happens when a tyrant demands loyalty. Then you say we're all in a lot of trouble.
Yes, when the loyalty is the loyalty to the tyrant and not to the community, the state, the republic, then we're in trouble, because it all gets into a single person. That is the general principle of the tyrant. That's almost the definition of tyranny. It's all about yourself. It's astonishing to me that we got into that situation, and that we elected that situation for ourselves. And that's why I wrote the book originally. I wrote my book because I was thinking about Richard III, Shakespeare's play Richard III, and I was thinking how remarkable it was that Shakespeare, living in the world that he lived in, thought that a tyrant would come to power by being elected, not by assassination, all the other ways you might think of, but by large numbers of people saying, okay, I want this.
Well, as you point out, tyrants surround themselves in the trappings of democracy, although they don't particularly want to exercise it. Now, tyrants, you write, really, according to Shakespeare, don't last very long. And the lesson of history is that sometimes they come back, but they don't last very long. I mean, Roy Cohn, Trump's mentor, said no public man can remain indefinitely at the center of controversy. Gandhi said something quite similar. Do you think that was Shakespeare's view, that tyrants eventually have to go down in ignominy in history?
They certainly do, but the question is how long it will take before that happens.
And what will happen to all of us while it's going on? Yeah.
One thing that I think Shakespeare depicted that is, it's of course a question that we're all asking ourselves now, but the example would be Macbeth or Richard III. What Shakespeare was fascinated by was someone who had immense charismatic presence, and then the air goes out of the balloon. He watches, Richard III is the great example of that. It's a play that's totally dominated by Richard and his personality. And then late in the play, starting in the fourth act, you begin to feel it drain away. And Shakespeare is quite gripped by that phenomenon. He's gripped by it partly just as a professional playwright, how you handle that situation, how you represent it, what it means for this energy to dissipate. And we're in that moment, I think, culturally, politically. It looks like the air is going out of the balloon, but we don't know.
Well, Stephen, unfortunately, we've come to the end of our time. This has been just marvelous, but I have a question for you. And the question is, are Shakespeare's politics meaningful in our time?
I think Shakespeare's politics are profoundly meaningful in our time. Not his political position on this or that, but his intelligence, his sense of the complexity of things, his sense of decency, of his loathing of cruelty, his very deep awareness of the fact that certain kinds of theatrical power are at once wonderful and dangerous, and that you have to try to understand them and protect yourself from the most destructive aspects of them and embrace the parts that can actually lead you to a deeper understanding.
So we must protect ourselves.
I think Shakespeare speaks to us more now than ever before.
We must protect ourselves. Thank you so much, Stephen Greenblatt, for coming by. And thank you for coming by. Tune in next week for more conversations. I'm Jim Zirin. Take care, be safe, and all the best.